Hey guys, tonight we're going to work on our Art Snack September Challenge. I have said in prior videos, or at least I think I said in prior videos, this box really didn't inspire me very much. I'm sorry. I guess I'm not sorry because I paid for the box, so I'm sorry to me that it didn't inspire me. So what I ended up finally settling on is a... is doing an illustration of a rose with a rose hip, because the colors I got are, where is it? Burnt umber, which is kind of a reddish brown, and dark pink, and they just really don't go together very well. And I'm trying to stick pretty close to what I got in the box. So in addition to what I got in the box, I'm going to use a Sailor Mitsuo Aida to do my inking. And this Japanese watercolor postcard paper, which I ordered from JetPens a really long time ago to review and never reviewed it. So we'll find out. I have been warned that it doesn't really handle like watercolor paper in the way you would think of watercolor paper. So I'm going to try to be very light with it, which will work out great because the only water media I'm using is this Zig Clean Color Real Brush. So I'm going to go ahead and draw the rose in time lapse, and I'll get back to you guys. So we've got that sketched out, and something I noticed is that this particular paper, like holding it upside down, sorry, there we go, has like a very cottony feel. It's sort of like drawing on sheets. And I also noticed that the knurled metal grip on the ArtSnacks Draft-O-Matic, if you are drawing for a long period of time, or if you tend to clench your pencil too tightly, basically if you're a convention commission artist, this will cut into your fingers. So that is definitely something you want to be aware of, which is why I've sort of moved away from pencils with this sort of a knurled grip. So next we're going to go ahead and ink this with the Sailor Mitsuo Aida. And the reason for that is graphite, like what we just sketched with, can ruin the nibs on your alcohol marker. So rather than ruin the nibs, I'll just go ahead and ink it. So I'm going to let this cure for 24 hours and I'll get back to you guys tomorrow with the rest of this challenge. Hey guys, so it's been 24 hours. My ink has had a chance to cure. So now we're going to go ahead and erase the graphite from this watercolor paper. And this watercolor paper does not seem to like erasing. So I'm going to go dig up a better eraser and I will erase and get back to you guys. All right, I grabbed a tiny scrap of a Tombow eraser. Hopefully that'll erase a little bit better. Before I was using a Pentel Click Erase. This Japanese origami paper is kind of linty, if that makes sense. So even moderately gentle erasing seems to be disturbing some of the surface texture and picking up some of the paper, which could be a problem. Now, I didn't have to use this paper. This paper was not included in the box. I did supply it myself. So I do take responsibility for paper performance issues. I have to stop every so often to peel a layer of paper off of my eraser so that I can get a fresh surface for erasing, because otherwise it just sort of glides on the paper surface. All right, looks like I've gotten most of the graphite off. So I'll go ahead. Try to get most of the eraser bits off the paper. Now the next thing I'm going to need to do is secure my paper to the tabletop, and I'm going to do that with some blue painter's tape. I have been forewarned by someone who is familiar with this paper that this watercolor paper does not handle like Western watercolor paper. So I'm going to try to be light-handed with my approach. So I have to admit, I do follow the ArtSnacks Instagram. That's not much of a confession. Confession is I've seen what other people got in their September boxes color-wise, and I feel like I really got kind of the short end of the stick. The dark pink is a beautiful color, sort of a rose color, but it doesn't really go very well with the burnt umber. So, since the ArtSnacks is sort of reliant on you only using the materials that come in your box, that kind of presents a problem for me. I would like to try and stay loyal to just the box, but I feel like I'm very limited by what's included. So I'm going to pull out a couple, maybe just one, possibly two, we'll see. I'm gonna pull out a couple of the PH Martins. Radiant watercolors. And we'll use those in addition to the Kuratake Kuracolor and the Zig Clean Color Real Brush. Now, since we're using alcohol marker, we do need to begin with that alcohol marker. That'll kind of prevent contamination with other markers. I'm going to go ahead and grab a colorless blender. And the first thing I want to do is I want to color all of the areas that would be influenced by this dark burnt umber color. Mm-hmm. And since this is watercolor paper, we are getting a lot of bleeding. And the Kuretake is extremely susceptible to colorless blender, it seems like. Unfortunately, the color it reveals is really unattractive. The color it blends to is like this kind of terrible highlighter color. And on this particular paper, it does not blend smoothly, which again is not a surprise. This is, after all, a type of watercolor paper. Look at all that terrible blending. Man, I kind of made a mistake, didn't I? All right, well, whole point of this is to see if we can't salvage our mistakes. And if you watch some of my other tutorial videos, you'll see that I do indeed use alcohol markers on mixed media paper and watercolor paper. And I do indeed do mixed media pieces with watercolor and alcohol markers. So this reaction's a little intense compared to what I'm used to. But we'll make it work. We'll figure it out. That's kind of the point of these challenges, is I like to dig myself a hole and bury myself in it and then see if I can't escape from it. Which is really disappointing that this Kur color is such an ugly color. Well, when blended, it turns into an ugly color. It's actually kind of a nice wine color, but it blends into garbage. All right, so we're going to use, rather not use that water brush, this water brush. We're going to use a water brush to apply our initial layers of the Zig Clean color, and we're going to go ahead and use the Ink Essentials craft sheet that's on my tabletop as a palette. Wow, this paper really does not handle like regular watercolor paper. Sinking feeling that this is going to end up being kind of a hot mess. Between you guys and me, this paper is a little bit like painting on toilet paper. And I don't know if it's because I wrecked the surface by accident by erasing my lines, or if it would always handle this way. All right, gonna let that toilet paper dry. All right, guys, that layer has dried. We're gonna try another layer. I am seriously having some concerns about this paper and how it handles. I mean, the person who warned me that it does not handle like regular watercolor paper really wasn't kidding. This is one of those instances where I don't know that I can salvage this, which is fine. That's part of what these challenges are about. Learning something new, even if that something new is, I don't care for this particular paper. Or I don't, this paper doesn't jive with how I like to paint. All right, so I'm gonna let that layer dry. I think my next layer will be a direct application, and then we'll try to knock in the background. All right, guys, we're gonna go directly in now with the Zig Clean Color Real Brush. Ooh, I don't know about this. I've used these before, and they usually apply color much more smoothly than that. I have a feeling I'm gonna end up doing this Art Snack Challenge again. All right, guys, if any of you have ever used Akashiya Edogami paper for watercolor stuff, and you can tell me how it's supposed to be used, because apparently I don't have a clue, please let me know in the comments below. I'm always interested in learning new things, especially when it comes to art supplies, and clearly I need help on this one. I'm going to try to finish this out, although I do not have high hopes for it. And I guess I'm going to end up doing an additional Art Snacks challenge, because this just is not cutting it. Just don't want to have my name attached to this one. It's okay, though. It was a learning experience. Whoa. And as I've told you guys in the past, it's good when y'all see me make mistakes. Hopefully that gives you guys courage to try something new that day. But in art, especially, what makes mistakes valuable is what we can learn from them. I'm going to let that dry, and then I'm going to go in with my radiant watercolors, and we'll just completely destroy this thing. All right, guys, while this dries, because like I said, I call it, it's going to end up being a disaster, I'm going to start redrawing the image on a different piece of paper. And hopefully tomorrow we can revisit this. I'm going to try and finish it on the Edogami paper, by the way. I'm not just giving up. But I don't expect this to go really well. Now, something that is already a problem, in my opinion, is the, where is it? Right here. This. Oh, you guys can't see that. Let's pull way, way, way out. The Kerr Color S. I just really am not enjoying how it handles. I don't really like the color either. I don't feel like the color goes really well with the content, and I can't blend it out. That's the big kicker. You know, you can make anything work if you can. I'm trying to get this in the shot too for y'all. If you can, you know, blend it out and make the colors work together, and it blends into this neon orange, which is just kind of a terrible color. And what I assume, and I don't actually know for a fact, maybe one of you guys can fill me in, I assume Art Snacks orders sets of these things, because you do get pricing breakdowns when you buy in bulk or when you buy sets. So, like, I assume that they buy, you know, a 120 color set, and that's what they send out. Everybody gets one color. And the problem with that is you're going to have people who get just terrible colors, colors that are hard to work with when they're all on their own. And this month I got one of those colors because it doesn't really blend out well. So it probably doesn't play well with other colors, even within its own set. know why I'm doing roses, to be honest. So I may also just cheat and only use the... I'm not even using the right pencil right now. It's up there. I did use the right pencil on this. And I didn't use the ruler, which I probably should have found a way to use. Anyway, I'm probably going to opt not to use the burnt umber in my ArtSnacks Revisited. I may not even ink it. If I'm not using an alcohol marker, I don't actually need to re-ink this. I can just go right over it, like as soon as I'm finished destroying this piece of paper over here. So I guess I will finish redrawing this and finish working on this. Paper is still wet. So I'll see you guys when this is dry. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and grab a synthetic brush. And I have a cup of clean water right there. And I'm going to continue to use my Essentials matte as a palette. Which will be the first time I've done it this way with these sort of watercolors. And I'm going to go ahead and put down two colors, chartreuse and calypso green. And you guys can kind of consider this sort of like a test run for my radiant watercolors field test, just sort of getting a feel for them. I'm getting, oh wow, that spreads out so much. It's really weird painting on this stuff. Gonna have to get the inside scoop on how this paper is actually supposed to be used. Because this is surely wrong. But I'll figure it out and get back to you guys. Ooh, I think I wanna try. Nope. Putting some juniper green in there too. Cause why not, right? Playing around, we're learning. This already looks terrible. So might as well really get our money's worth. Blending is certainly not a problem on this paper. Or rather, blending is a little too easy on this paper. It just goes everywhere. Not much control. Watch this. It's going to go all up in that flower. Okay, so this is definitely a paper that you can't really use with water. Wow, did y'all see that? It was almost like I dropped rubbing alcohol onto it the way it created a ring. This paper is crazy. I was going to send this as a postcard to my mom, but this, no. She deserves a lot better than this. I think she'd be very gracious about it and the whole time wonder why I wasted my money going to art school. And this is going to just be terrible. Can I push that out or blend it in any? It's kind of like a neat, oh. It's kind of like a neat color chromatography effect. Totally not planned or really wanted. But since I have already decided this is just gonna be a total hot mess, I've embraced how terrible this is gonna be. Honestly, I just want to play on the Edogami paper with my radiant watercolors. Just for like decent like blends and splotches. Pretty good at that. If you're just like noodling around and not really attempting to get anywhere. There, that looks great, right, guys? Oh, I'm so good. I'm such a great artist. Oh, it's all done. I'm gonna sell for a whole bunch of money. Just look how great that is. No. Please keep watching for the improved version of at least some of these materials. If not, we'll die trying together. See you guys soon. All right, guys, let's have a fresh start. We're gonna start yet again with this lovely dark pink that came in my art snacks for September. Oh man, it handles so much better on this. I'm currently using Fluid 100, which is a cotton rag based watercolor paper. I guess after that Edogami mistake, you could call it a Western style watercolor paper. And right now I'm just using a water brush to pick up color from the mat and apply it into the flower. So basically I'm painting with this the way I would watercolor. And I'm kind of avoiding a direct application right now because I have noticed that some of these watercolor markers, if you apply them directly, they're hard to blend out and they will leave a line indicating where you first applied them. So I feel like it's a little bit better to build up your colors. All right, so now I'm going to try to darken things up a little bit with a little bit of direct application, which you can see is much, much darker. And then I will blend it out using that water brush. We'll see how well that works. little bit better, a little bit more control than we had before, which was pretty much no control. As I mentioned, I've never worked with origami paper before. I've had some sitting around in my studio for a long time, and I thought it was worth giving it a shot, trying out something new. And I really don't mind failing in front of you guys. I mean, it is a little embarrassing. It's always embarrassing to, you know, swing and miss. But I really want you guys to feel comfortable making mistakes. And the only real way I can think of to encourage you guys with that is to make some mistakes for you. Speaking of mistakes, a little bitty drop of the pink got flung onto my paper, and see, it does not want to budge. These are kind of fun to paint with, though. Alright, so I'm going to let that dry before I come back to it. Alright, so it seems like we can build up decent depth of color on different watercolor paper. So if you want to use these little watercolor markers more like watercolors, then you are going to want to go for watercolor paper that is more designed for layering. As I mentioned earlier, I really, really do not like this color, and I don't like how it handles when it blends. Unfortunately, ArtSnacks only sent two coloring tools this month, so that really limits what I can do with the materials they sent. So in this sort of ArtSnacks part two, I am going to again give the concentrated watercolors a shot. And we're going to be using chartreuse, calypso green, and juniper green yet again, along with a cup of clean water and a synthetic brush. And we'll get to that once this layer dries. All right, guys, so I am going to try working with these radiant watercolors again, and I'm going to use my Ink Essentials craft mat as sort of a cheap and easy palette. And no, I'm not paid to promote it. I happen to like the product. I think most artists, in fact, would like the product. It is 110% not marketed towards us, but you know, that doesn't mean we shouldn't give it a shot. So I am using a Princeton brush sent in one of my prior ArtSnacks. This is not the Kalinske Sable that was sent in ArtSnacks Inktober. This is a synthetic Kalinske that was sent, I don't know, The boxes are getting kind of unmemorable for me, so I can't tell you. Certainly after June, probably, maybe it was June, actually, now that I'm thinking about it. Because June was the watercolor box. Really, really like how this synthetic green layers over that. Alright, so that's dried. Now we can add another layer. And those of you who are familiar with my work in general, you know that I don't normally do bright saturated colors, but you know, every now and then it's really fun to be able to use these sort of colors and not really worry about whether or not they look kind of garish together. That's okay. It's fine if they look kind of garish together, because that's not a problem today. And if that, I mean, that's something that, even though I will be great, I'll be happy when this year of unboxings is over, because I'm kind of tired of doing them. And they are pretty expensive to do. That is something that I'm grateful for this year, is that it has encouraged a more adventurous artistic streak in me, made me embrace, or helped me embrace, playing around with things and just sort of letting go and seeing what happens. Being an artist doesn't really come naturally to me. I'm more of a writer, or at least I consider myself that, but I have spent the majority of my adult life, in fact, all of my adult life and the majority of my life pursuing art as an interest and then later as a career. So, you know, for me, it was always like figuring out what techniques would get me what I was looking for art-wise, would help me achieve the end result I wanted, and then learning those techniques. And spending this year doing the unboxings and playing around with a bunch of materials and playing around on camera for you guys with a bunch of materials hasn't always been easy, and sometimes it's kind of discouraging when things don't really turn out the way I'd like them to. But it's been really good for me to sort of just like break out of my comfort zone. Now, is that, you know, a recommendation that you spend $20 a month or $30 a month or $40 a month, or, you know, I don't know how much Scrawler Box costs off the top of my head. Is that a recommendation that you go out and spend that kind of money? No, not necessarily. But, I mean, there was a silver lining to all the time that I have put into these unboxings and put into the reviews and put into the videos. So even though I'll be happy when this year of reviews is over and I can go back to focusing on more detailed tutorials for markers and watercolor, I am happy that I spent the time doing these things and learning something new, because I'm not the sort of person who, when it comes to art, I'm not necessarily willing to try something that's just completely out of my comfort zone. right, guys, so it's time to start filling in the background. And I want to do, and I might regret this, because these synthetic colors can be a little finicky to handle. I want to first do an all-over wash. Well, a background wash, really. A background fill with juniper green, which is a beautiful color, but it is super synthetic. That's like the color of children's toys and candy. So, beautiful, beautiful color, but fake as heck. Gosh, it's tempting just to leave. I like kind of envision doing like a blue hued foliage background, which is a common thing I do in my field tests, because it implies like leaves and stuff in shadow. But this color is just so beautiful. I almost want to, and it like really pops nicely. I almost want to leave it as is rather than risk. We'll see. You know what? I'll fill it in and we'll see. It's a nice color though. That's not really a green at all. It's really like a teal. Really makes those roses pop, though. This one I would feel a lot more comfortable sending to my mom. All right, guys, this has had some time to dry, so I'm gonna attempt, we'll see how well this attempt goes. I'm going to attempt to add some shading to a few of these leaves, you know, bump that contrast. And again, we'll let that dry. All right, guys, let's work on getting this wrapped up. I'm going to go back in on the roses. Add a little bit of contrast. This color seems to layer nicely. And then use a little bit of white gouache, also not included in that art snacks, to add some contrast, since some of the contrast was lost. Often with these synthetic dye-based colors, the color will bleed through the gouache And that is okay by me because that makes it look intentional. What basically happens is these dyes are not permanent at all. Any amount of water will reactivate them. So when you're adding white gouache, you are basically reactivating some of those dyes. And that goes for the Zig Real Brush, as much as it goes for the Radiant Watercolors. So it's actually a little more believable. It doesn't just like stand out like, oh, you messed up, so you put a bunch of white paint on top of it. I think we're gonna call it for ArtSnacks September Challenge, or I guess September Homage. So I hope you guys were able to learn something, even if the only thing you learned was that Kuretake Kuracolor in Burnt Sienna turns into a hot mess when you add blender, or that Itagami paper does not handle at all like watercolor paper. Oh, you can't see. Hang on. And should most definitely be used differently. I hope you guys enjoyed watching my ArtSnacks challenge for September. I hope you forgive me for my failures. It was a learning experience for me this time too. And that's always exciting and a little scary. And it didn't quite go the way I'd hoped it would go, but you know, it's okay. Hopefully that inspires you guys to go and make some mistakes of your own. If you enjoyed this video, please remember to hit like and consider subscribing for more content like this. Every month in 2016, I have reviewed, overviewed, and demonstrated the supplies inside of ArtSnacks and Sketchbox. So if that's the sort of content you like, please check out my ArtSnacks versus Sketchbox playlist. For more of this review, please head over to the blog nattosoup.blogspot.com. And in a couple weeks, the rest of this particular review should be available for you to read. That includes links to all the videos, prices, and my personal thoughts as to which box was the better buy for this month. If you're into art supplies in general, my blog is a great place to be as well. If you really, really like this video, please take a moment to share it to your social networks. Doing so is a huge favor for me, and I would really, really appreciate it. You're helping me out a lot when you take the time to do that. And if you would like to help support content like this and would like to help me produce more of it, head on over to my Patreon at patreon.com/nattosoup. For information on how to join my community. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me today. I will see you again really soon with my Sketchbox Basic September Challenge video. I'm Becca Hilburn from Natta Soup Studio. See you guys later. Bye.